embedding layers, it has a vacuum on one side and 916 nanometer thick layer of aluminum gallium arsenide triple alloy with 30% of aluminum. For total internal reflection to be present, the refractive index of the core needs to be larger than the refractive indexes of the cladding layers. So the sample is designed that the refractive index of the core layer is around 3.6. Refractive indexes of the cladding layers is 1 for vacuum and 3.2 for triple alloy with 30% of aluminum concentration. Waveguide core contains a 13.7 gallium arsenide quantum well in the middle. The sample was fabricated at the by the St. Petersburg State University epitaxy group based in the Research Center Nanophotonics. Sample was carefully investigated with the reflection and photoluminescence spectroscopy, and it showed four main spectral peculiarities at the following energies. These are respectively the bulk exciton in gallium arsenide substrate and bulk layer, heavy hole exciton in the quantum well, light hole exciton in the quantum well, and the exciton in the waveguide core layer made of triple alloy with 3% concentration. It is impossible to inject light in total internal reflection waveguide just from the upper half space. So there is two main solutions to this problem. First, and the most obvious, is inserting the light into the edge surface of the waveguide, like shown on the picture. But in this case, the experiment will be very sensitive even to a tiniest jitter in the optics, because optical adjustments need to be perfect to inject the light into 1 micrometer spot. And the closed cycle cryostats in our possession are cursed with a strong vibration, so it's almost impossible to go this way. Also, there is a lot of technical difficulties in the procedure of placing the microobjective inside the cryostat. Second solution, the one we used in our experiments, is the creation of the grating coupler on the surface of the waveguide. We used argon ion etching through an electron beam lithographed PMMA mask. The grating depth was set to 100 nanometers. The grating period was set to 245 nanometers, so that inside the sample there existed only the one diffraction order of the grating at near normal angles of incidence. In this case, it's just much easier to analyze the data because you have just one probe beam. Here you can see the microscopic data showing the grating surface. It's not looking perfect, but at the end, it proved to do what it's supposed to do. We were able to insert the light into the waveguide by these gratings. During the optical experiments, the sample was kept at the closed cycle helium cryostat at the temperature of around 10 Kelvin. The continuous wave infrared laser with an adjustable wavelength was used as a probe beam, hitting the diffraction grating at near normal angles of incidence. Laser beam intensity was stabilized to compensate intensity fluctuations for different wavelengths. The system containing a rotating cube and the lens was used for angle scanning process. The photoelectric multiplier was used to detect the light which have entered the waveguide through the diffraction grating, traveled some significant distance through the waveguide, continuously interacting with the quantum well, and left the waveguide through the cleft edge surface. The signal was synchronized with the angle scanning frequency. Therefore, with this setup, we were able to investigate angle span of around 3.5 degrees and wavelengths from 790 to 830 nanometers. But in fact, we already knew the positions of the exciton lines by previous experiments with the reflection and photoluminescence spectroscopy, and we focused on the wavelength span from 808 to 814.5 nanometers, covering both heavy hole and light hole excitons in the quantum well. The raw data obtained in the experiment was already showing the presence of photon-exciton interaction. Two-dimensional data obtained in the experiment was transposed, and the exciton polariton signal was fit with the Gaussian curves. We were interested in angle wavelength positions of the peaks and their relative intensity. The data was fit with an avoided crossing model presented here. A, B, and E0 are free fitting parameters. And parameter W, or omega, multiplied by 2 corresponds to the Rabi splitting of the system. We have investigated photon-exciton interaction for both light hole and heavy hole excitons, and both even and uneven photonic modes, altering probe intensity, probe light polarization, and even the temperature, which is not listed here. On this slide and on the next one, you can see the experimental data fit with an avoided crossing model shown on the previous slide. And also you can see the calculated Rabi splitting values for different experiment conditions. Here's the data for all three fabricated grating couplers. We did three of them. The distance light need to travel through the waveguide increases with a grating number from 1 to 3. But there is no particular dependence on the distance, unfortunately. On the figure, both S and P polarizations of the probe light are shown. And you can see that in one polarization, the light is better interacting with one type of exciton, and another polarization with another type of exciton. Here is the angle resolved peak positions and avoidant crossing fit for different photonic modes of the waveguide. One spectra is for the even mode, and the other is for uneven mode. And you can see the difference, slight difference, in the behavior of the exciton polaritons. We have studied the new object, aluminum gallium arsenide planar total internal reflection waveguide, with a thin gallium arsenide quantum well in the midpoint of the core layer. We have optimized the parameters of both sample fabrication and the experiment. We were able to demonstrate the presence of the strong coupling effect in such systems between an exciton in the quantum well and photonic modes of the planar waveguide. The behavior of these exciton polaritons are in perfect condition, in perfect agreement with an existing avoided crossing model. Maximum Rabi splitting values obtained in the experiment are 4 millielectron volts for S polarization and heavy hole exciton, and around 4.1 millielectron volts for P polarization and light hole exciton. In the future investigations, we plan to improve the quality of the grating couplers and quality of the getter structure under investigation. To enhance the light injection effectiveness and the effectiveness of light and exciton interaction. And also we look forward to study the new objects. We have a few of them. One is the same waveguide, but instead of the one single quantum well, we have a multiple quantum well structure. Second one is the thin waveguide structure, and also we have a waveguide with a quantum well in the cladding layer and evanescent wave connection with the photonic mode of the waveguide. So that's all. Research Center Nanophotonics is open to any scientific collaboration. We have molecular beam epitaxy set up, nanofabrication complexes, and optical laboratory for express sample characterization and other investigations. I sincerely thank you for your attention and wish you an interesting day at the conference.
I was amazed by Rabi splitting values 4 and 4.03. Are you responsible for this accuracy?
No.
Or this was just a psychological effect?
I'm sorry. Yeah, I know it's a huge mistake to
Okay, sorry. Yeah. Next question. Have you estimated theoretically Rabi splittings for heavy and light Hall excitons?
Unfortunately, no. We only calculated the behavior of the empty waveguide. And then afterwards, our scientific director, Gleb Kozlov, suggested to make a structure with a quantum well and just do an experiment. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, we still did not make theoretical calculations for such an object. And I think I will try to maintain them this summer.
Okay. One more question.
I have two questions. First, you said you did experiment at different temperature. Does Rabi splitting depend on temperature?
We did a different kind of an experiment. Instead of scanning the wavelength, we tried to scan the temperature, because with the temperature, the position of the excitant line shifts. So it was just a single experiment. We saw something when the excitant line passed.
Not enough complete data.
Yep.
And another question about the model. Is this a model of linearly coupled to linear oscillator or something more complicated?
I think it's a linear coupled to linear oscillator, because the model was quite simple.
Thank you.
As Gleb always does.
Okay. Maybe I can ask a short question. So did you try, so these were propagation experiments, yes? You were coming,
yep,
with the laser light, and you can do some photoluminescence, for example, experiments. Did you try to do this?
No.
So you can excite emission in your waveguide and try to take a look how it is coupled out in order to estimate the efficiency of your grating or something like this. So how do you know what is the efficiency of your grating structure?
Unfortunately, we already know that the efficiency of the grating is terrible. But with this setup, we can inject something and detect something. But when you measure it with a photoluminescence, it's critical to have a high effectiveness, because it's not much light coming out. And we know that the gratings are of a bad quality from the experiments in the Dortmund University when we tried to measure these effects in the reflection.
I know. Okay, thank you. So if there are no more questions, then let us thank the speaker again. Thank you. So, and the next speaker is Марина Семина from Йофа Институт. And the title of the talk is Fine Structure of Rydberg Excitons in Cuprous Oxide. And this work, as far as I know, has been done together in collaboration with the group of Manfred Bayer in University of Dortmund. So experiment in Dortmund and theory in Yoff Institute, yes. So, Marina, please.
Good afternoon, everybody. Today I will speak about fine structure of Rydberg exciton in corpus oxide. Actually, my talk will consist of two parts. The first part is about fine structure of excitons in bulk corpus oxide without any applied external field. And the second part is about a Stark effect for excitons. And I will begin with some introduction. Corpus oxide is a classical material for exciton physics. First observation of Vanier-Mott excitons were made in this material. And in 21st century, with development of new experimental technique, people returned to this material. And for example, here show the recent results for observation excitons in corpus oxide with level number up to 25. And for example, for and this large quantum number n, the radius of these excitons are as large as micron. And this object can be treated, can be seen as some analog of Rydberg atoms in semiconductor physics. This observation was possible because of two factors. First factor is the rather large body energy of an exciton, and the second factor is the very high quality of the samples. The simplest way to treat exciton is a hydrogen-like model, but the deviation from the hydrogen X series can be seen for this series of lines. And for example, if you look carefully at the high energy flank of dominant P line, that is dipole load for this material, you can see some feature that can be attributed for could be attributed to F excitons, and at n more than 6, additional feature appears that can be attributed to H states. It is necessary to note that the splittings between P and F states is the effect of the complex valence band structure of the material, but the splitting inside the F state, being the F states a triplet, is the manifestation of the cubic symmetry of corpus oxide, the manifestation of the fact that this material is not isotropic. Corpus oxide has OH point symmetry group, and this leads to appearance one line for P exciton, three lines for F excitons, and five lines for H excitons. One can see only three lines for F states because the fourth state is very weak and has small oscillation strength. Here is the Hamiltonian for relative motion of an exciton. This Hamiltonian includes isotropic part and the cubic part. And because of the spin orbit interaction in this material is the same order of magnitude as exciton bonding energy, we have to take into account all valence band, not only the top of the valence band. Here is our results to calculate binding energy of p states. You can neglect the valence band. Warping, and so here is the dependence of the binding energy of p states on quantum number n. The dots is the experimental results, and the red line is the theoretical calculation. You can see the very good agreement between experiment and theory. And here shown the splitting between F and P states. To calculate position of P states, we have the some average position of this triplet. And here, comparison, and it is very good also. And it is necessary to note that both results has no adjustable parameter. We took well-known band parameter of corpus oxide and solved the Schrödinger equation. And now we move to fine structure of F states. And here it is necessary to take into account the cubic part of the Hamiltonian. And we have one adjustable parameter, delta, that is responsible to valence band warping. And here shown our results. And you can see good agreement between experiment and theoretical calculation. And by this comparison, it is allowed to obtain the value of the latitude parameter responsible to valence band warping, gamma 3. And it is interesting to note that in this material, in cuprous oxide, gamma 3 is larger than gamma 2. This result is in agreement with first principle calculation. And later, another rock appeared, and there authors made another parameterization, but this parameterization also has negative gamma. Now I move to the second part of my talk, and I will speak about Stark effect for excitons. Here is some example. This is an experimental figure, and this is spectrum of an exciton for n equals to 3, the third state of an exciton. Here, electric field, here in all presented figures, electric field is applied along the light propagation axis, and different polarization will be studied. The external electric field mixes exciton states and therefore makes forbidden in zero field states optically active. Our goal is to study the transmission spectrum dependence on the strength of electric field, light propagation direction, and incident light polarization. This slide devoted to some introduction to Stark effect. The simplest way to treat exciton and electric field is hydrogen-like like model. Here is a Hamiltonian. And for example, the correction to first state of first exciton state energy is shown here, and the applied electric field will split the degenerate states corresponding to the same n equals to 2, 3 and so on. But in real semiconductor crystals, the accidental degeneracy characterizing the hydrogen atom is lifted due to complex valence band structure, non-parabolicity, short-range correction to electron-hole interaction, and other effects. And our calculation result of which will be shown a moment later, take into account the splitting between states with different orbital momentum. Also, we take into account the exchange interaction between electron and hole and the spin orbital interaction. To calculate transmission spectra, we take into account dipole load, P-shell transition, and also quadrupole load S-shell transitions. Here our results. This is figures 4, n equals to 3. This is theory and experiment. The green lines is a calculated energy levels positions. This is result corresponds to this geometry, and you can see P state and G5 half states. And now we keep the same orientation but take different polarizations. And picture changed dramatically. Appears new lines. And these lines correspond to SD states. Exchange interaction mix strongly S and D3 half states. And for example, in this state, the admixture of D states is about 25%, and here the admixture of a state is about 25%. And now we change the light propagation direction. Here the picture also changes once more. And in this geometry, there is no polarization dependence. In our calculation, we somewhat adjust energy levels position at zero field, and also we adjust exchange interaction energy to have a better comparison, better agreement with experiment. And I have to note that although we adjust energy positions, it is still in very good agreement with our more complicated calculation in the zero field. Here is a review for higher states and 4 and 5. And the picture become even more complicated because of appearance of F states, for example. And here is my conclusion. The exciton states with angular momentum 1, 3, and 5 are observed in one photon absorption spectra, bulk corpus oxide. And these states are splitted due to cubic symmetry of a crystal. This is respond to the first part of my talk. The results of numerical calculation with only one fitting parameter in good agreement with the experiment. An electric field mixes exciton states with different parity, for example, with angular momentum 1 and 0, and 1 and 3, P states and D states, P states and S states. And these states that are dark in zero field become optically active. The absorption, spectra in electric field demonstrates strong dependence on light propagation direction and light polarization. The calculated spectra of exciton in electric field are in good agreement with the experiment. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. So it's time for questions. Okay, I can bring.
Yeah. Last. Here?
Yeah, this one. The result of green lines on top of bright.
Green lines is calculated.
Oh, is it the theory?
Yes, it's theory. Ah,
okay. So this is in theory. You have a lot less lines, no?
Yes, because these lines are calculated energy levels position, but not every state is optically active. This is all states, but this is only optically active states.
Continuation of the same question. How did you match electric field on the experimental and theoretical scale?
The coefficient between theoretical and experimental electric field is somewhat fitting parameter because the experimental setup is rather complicated, and it is assumed by experimentalists that there is some screening of electric field inside the sample, and this screening of the surface.
Okay, you have to manually fit this coefficient.
Yes.
Thank you. And the second question. I'm not only expressed, but I am confident into the 6 significant digits in spectroscopic data. Couple of words of your spectroscopic technique, please.
I'm not responsible for experiment, but I think that resolution is about nano EV. I don't know, sorry.
What single mode that is? It's a single mode and a set of single mode elements, not single player current. No, that is.
I have an extremely naive question concerning screening in this system. I assume that the Rydberg of 90 millielectron volt is above the LO phonon energies, while the binding energy of IN levels is much lower than LO phonon energy. So I would assume that the dielectric constant changes somehow from epsilon naught to epsilon infinity when you go through the ladders. But maybe I'm completely wrong. It's a naive question again.
In our calculation, we don't assume the dielectric constant varies from one end to another. Yes, this is the effect of the material parameters.
Okay, I think we have to go further. Thank you very much for your presentation. And the next speaker is Daria Gapunova. The name of the talk is Optical Diagnostics of the Excitation Transfer and Relaxation Process in Gallium Arsenide, Aluminium Gallium Arsenide Heterostructures with Quantum Wells. And this work has been done in the Institute of Physics of Microstructures, Nizhny Novgorod.
Oh, thank you very much. Here is the title of my presentation and the list of scientists participated in this work from our institute, and samples were provided us by a group of Professor Zhuravlev from Simbirsk and Andrei Krystov from Sheffield University, United Kingdom. Here is the outline. I would start with some short introduction and describe the situation in studied field. Then I'll talk about the experiment, about experimental setup and samples, and show photoluminescence and photoluminescence excitation spectra. And we will discuss the disagreement between the theory and experiment. After that, I'll show some new results and photoluminescence spectra, which seems interesting for me, which have some unusual behavior, and try to explain it, or maybe somebody of you will explain it better. And then we'll come to the conclusion. The processes of excitations transferred because of tunneling have been studied, for example, in this work. And they are important if the barrier thickness is less than 5 nanometers. When barriers between quantum wells are more than 10 nanometers, the time of tunneling rises exponentially, and you should take into account some other processes. The thermal excitation is important for the high temperatures when the carrier energy is enough to overcome the potential barrier between quantum wells, and it was studied in this work. But in the case of wide barriers and low temperatures, you should take into account some other processes. And the most commonly used model here is model proposed by Foster and then developed by Dexter. And this model is based on the resonant dipole-dipole interaction between the parts of some microsystems. But in the case of direct band semiconductors, the probability of radiating is large, and processes because of their reabsorption of radiation should be taken into account. The radiative lifetime there is less than 1 nanosecond. And in this work, these processes have been studied. The processes of reabsorption of exciton radiation between narrow and wide quantum wells separated by a barrier of 16 nanometers. But there was a coincidence of energy levels in adjacent quantum wells. Our situation is different. And in this work, we studied the non-resonant radiative exciton transfer by the near field in the quantum wells without coincidence of energy levels in adjacent quantum wells. And the main idea here is that the radiation of the exciton from the narrow quantum well affect to the intensity of radiation of the wide quantum well. But a lot of questions are still remains, and that is the point of this work. Here is the design of the structure under investigation, and the active part of this structure consists of two quantum wells separated by a tunnel park barrier. Parameters are shown here. And here is the schematic band diagram for this structure with the position of electrons and hole levels. Just briefly about the model we used. The oscillating, the radiating exciton was assumed as the radiating dipole in the plane of the first quantum well. And if the distance between quantum well is an order of magnitude less than the wavelength of transition for this material, we should put into the electric field strings the terms of the near field components. Then we calculate the part of radiation absorbed in the transition from the hole into the electron subband, and get such an expression for the absorption coefficients from the heavy hole and light hole subbands. This result was obtained by the perturbation theory in dipole approximation, so it valid if the distance between dipoles and a quantum well is not larger than the Bohr radius of exciton, and the value of these coefficients are smaller than unity. An experiment. We measured the low temperature photoluminescence and photoluminescence excitation spectra yielding the tunable titan sapphire laser continuous wave, which was tunable in 0.2 nanometers. And we used the matrix CCD sensor to detect the signal. Here is just to illustrate how we measured the photoluminescence spectra. And photoluminescence excitation spectra. And here is the photoluminescence. You can see two peaks corresponds to the photoluminescence from the one, the narrow quantum well, and the second, the wide quantum well. Intensive line here is somehow dispersed or scattered laser radiation in the geometry we used previously. Now we modified the experimental setup that allowed us to not to collect the scattered laser radiation into the optical system. And we put the monochromator into the zero order. So we can see on the CCD sensor the image of the surface of the sample. And we focused the laser into the relatively small spot and choose on the sample surface the area without scattering objects. And now this is still the signal from the laser, but it is relatively small. And now we're able to measure the intensity of the photoluminescence just in the resonance excitation. We can express the intensity of the second photoluminescence signal from the second quantum well through the intensity of the first quantum well. The first term here is the part of laser radiation come to the second quantum well, and this term concerns the radiation from the exciton of the first quantum well, the narrow quantum well. The ratio of the intensities for the second quantum well in resonant excitation and out of the resonant excitation looks like this. So we can express the intensity of the second quantum well radiation through the intensity of the first And this coefficient beta from omega looks like this, and it is just slightly depends on omega because alpha qw2 is about 1-2%, and this is just a number. So this coefficient shouldn't depend on the experiment conditions, for example, from the intensity of excitation. There are experimental results. Here are photoluminescence excitation spectra. Dashed line is for the narrow, the first quantum well. And you can see here two peaks, which are from the heavy Hall exciton and light Hall exciton. And this line is for the second quantum well. There are no resonances for the second quantum well here. But you see the increase of the photoluminescence intensity. This peak originates from the transition of the third heavy Hall level to electron summon of the second quantum well. The ratio of intensities for the first quantum well in heavy Hall and light Hall exciton here is about 3, and the ratio of intensities for the second quantum well here is about 405. When we changed the excitation power, the ratio of intensities here is about 2.4, and for the second quantum well is about 1.5. How it can happen? The calculation predicted here that the increase in intensities for the second quantum well should be the same ratio as for heavy Hall and light Hall exciton in the first narrow quantum well. Here is the photoluminescence over the second wide quantum well near the resonant excitation of the heavy Hall exciton in the narrow quantum well. And you can see then that when we go through this resonance, the peak shifted here to the lower energies, and when we increase the excitation power, to the higher energies, and then shifted back. You know that in heterostructures with quantum well, even if they are undoped, there is an embedded electric field. In this work, we calculated the distribution of such a field for the structure with quantum wells. And for our situation, I suppose that there are some areas on the sample surface which are charged positively or negatively, and the scale of these areas is about 1-2 microns. And that area has produced electric field which penetrate into the sample depths for some microns too, and first, or maybe the second quantum well too is in that field. So when we resonantly excite the quantum wells, photo-excited carriers compensate this field because of Coulomb scattering, and this caused the shift in the position of the photoluminescence, and change the overlapping of the wave function too, so that affect on the intensity of photoluminescence. And one more interesting thing here. When we resonantly excite the heavy Hall exciton in the first quantum well, we have seen the narrow intensive peaks here. The different colors here indicate the different energy of excitation. First assumption here is this is the scattered laser. It isn't so, because here is the intensity of scattered laser, and in the resulting spectra we subtracted this signal. The second assumption is that this is the resonance scattering. It isn't so too, because the resonance scattering and absorption should be at the same wavelength. And this is the photoluminescence excitation for the broad peak and for the narrow, and you can see that the energy of the maximum is are different. Maybe this is the beginning of stimulated emission. It isn't so because we see no dependence on the excitation power. So this is a series of spectra under different temperatures. And you can see that with the temperature increase, this narrow intensive peak became lower. Here is the photoluminescence excitation for the narrow peak and for this broad peak. And you see that with temperature increase from 4 to 10 Kelvin, it drops. And then intensity stay about the same. And the maximum of this peak shifted into the lower energy. How I can explain it? If there are some potential fluctuation in the energy of a conduction band or valence band, there are some states which without electric field may cause only the broadening of the peak. But in the presence of electric field, some of the states are lower than another. And if carriers can stay here for the time enough to radiation, by the direct excitation in this state, we will see the narrow intensive peaks. And this effect will be decreased by the temperature. That is, we see in experiment. So, conclusion. The new experimental setup allowed us to see the photoluminescence by the direct excitation into the transition of Hadahal exciton. Theoretically predicted increase in the photoluminescence intensity due to near-field energy transfer can't answer the questions about the intensity of photoluminescence, and we should take into account the electric field, the embedded electric field. And we observed sharp peaks in the photoluminescence spectra, which may originate from the states of the fluctuation of the potential fluctuation. So that's all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. So this talk is open for question.
I found interesting the effect of the change of the spectrum of the ground exciton photoluminescence while changing the Leibnitz of the excitation. So you have some explanation, and if some your theoretical estimations are in agreement with this shift.
Do you mean the shift because of the Stark effect?
The dependence of the spectrum on the line widths of the excitation.
Mm-hmm. We are in a linear regime that there should be no difference.
Can you show this spectrum?
What do you mean? Here?
Okay, yes. Yes, 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 yes. Figures at the bottom. So the spectrum
here?
1, 3.
Here?
Yes, 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 yes. And excitation energy is changing, and the luminescence line peak is also shifting, yes?
No. Here is the energy of the photon of excitation. We come through the resonance in the first quantum well.
Okay, so what is the mechanism? You are.
I think that when you come to the resonance, there are a lot of photoexcited carriers that compensated the embedded electric field. And because of Stark effect, we have the shift of line position. And the change in the photoluminescence intensity is due to this effect too, because when the quantum well is in the electric field, the overlapping of the wave functions of holes and electrons changes, so the intensity changes too.
Not a question, but some comment. You can control electric fields in situ by means of non-resonant illuminations, by red light, for example.
Yes, I think yes.
Okay, maybe I can ask a question. So you did only continuous wave measurements. So maybe in your case, some information you could get from time resolved measurements.
Yes, we do conduct some time resolved measurements. And what can I say about the influence of the radiation from the narrow quantum well on the photoluminescence intensity of the second quantum well? We can calculate the part from the narrow quantum well as a new source lasting during the exciton transition in the narrow well. And so we should measure the difference in the dependence from time of the intensity of the second quantum well. And the situation is like for this. I couldn't just measure the part concerning of the concerning with the just radiation influence from the first quantum well, but there is the part of the electric field influence too.
But do you see some changes in the time?
Yes, yeah? Some changes, of course.
Okay, thank you. So it is. If there are no more questions, then we can speak. Thank you very much again. So the next talk will be given by Mikhail Glazov from Yofa Institute. And the title of the talk is Excitons Bound to Stacking Forts in Gallium Arsenide, Fine Structure and Non-Reciprocity Effect.
Hey, thank you for the introduction, and it's a great pleasure for me to be here. And I'm going indeed to continue the excitonic topic of this session by speaking about novel two-dimensional system where you can have excitons, and there the quality of excitonic spectra can really be very high. So this work is a result of big collaboration between our theoretical group together with Professor Ivchenko and Dr. Durnev here at Yofa Institute. The samples were prepared by our colleagues in Germany, by Arne Ludwig and Andreas Wick. And the main experimental efforts came from the group of Kai-Mei Fu from University of Washington in United States. So the plan of my talk is very simple. I shall start with a short introduction, and I shall try to explain you, if you don't know it already, what are the stacking faults in gallium arsenide. Then I shall present the experimental results of especially magnetoluminescence of excitons bound to the stacking faults. And finally, there will be some puzzles, and I shall try to explain those puzzles within our quite simple theoretical model. So let me try to remind you, of course, in this audience, probably everyone knows what are the stacking faults, but still, So let us assume that we grow, say, gallium arsenide or any other cubic crystal, and let us assume that we grow it along the axis 1, 1, 1. So in this case, you can imagine the crystal just as the sequence of planes. It is known, this sequence ABC. It is like you put balls on a two-dimensional surface as a honeycomb lattice. Then you put the next layer of balls on top of the first layer, and there are different empty positions for the balls. So you put the first layer, say, in the positions A, then the second one goes in the positions B, and then for the third layer, you have two options. You either put them in the third type of non-equivalent positions C, or you return back to the positions A. So for cubic lattice, the growth is ABC, 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 and so on, and you get normal gallium arsenide crystal. However, if something happens, and if for some reason the crystal tries to grow as a wurtzite, as we heard in the morning sessions, then you can have a kind of error here in the arrangement. You can go from ABC to AB and then again to A. So one of the crystalline planes is missing. Or you can put actually extra crystalline plane as well. And so such absent or extra crystalline plane is known as a stacking fault. And here is a very schematic illustration of this. So here the orange balls are for layer A, then layer B, then layer C. So here the arrangement is okay. And here the lattice is distorted. And here you can see that blue line, blue plane is missing. ABC, AB, ABC. So you can clearly see that here is a defect. One of the planes is missing. And moreover, here in the end of the stacking fault, you have a dislocation. So typically stacking faults are studied together with dislocations. And these are very well-known defects. And in optical microscopy, you can see those stacking faults as a so-called oval defects just on the ordinary 001 surface of the gallium arsenide. So here is the scheme. Just once again, you have an ordinary surface, 001, and you have kind of four non-equivalent 111 planes shown here. They form a kind of pyramid, and so the stacking faults could be any of those planes. So in principle, there are intrinsic or extrinsic stacking faults. Then you have either extra plane or one plane missing, but it doesn't matter for the point of the following. And once again, I just want to attract your attention to the symmetry of these stacking faults. So this is the crystalline lattice of the gallium arsenide. So red balls and blue balls are anions and cations. And 1-1-1 plane, which is the plane of the stacking fault, is shown here by a magenta triangle. So you can see that this system, the stacking fault, so this plane, has a threefold rotation axis, 1-1-1 axis, and three vertical reflection planes which are perpendicular to this stacking fault plane. So the overall symmetry of the stacking fault is C3V, and it will be important for the following. So as I already mentioned, in principle, the stacking faults have been studied for a long time already, but typically people studied the defects which are pair of adjacent stacking faults. So you have one stacking fault and then another right on top of it. And then the distance between those stacking faults fluctuates, and you have a kind of strong and homogeneous broadening in this system, and the excitonic spectra are not very nice. However, our colleagues are able to fabricate the structure that you have four stacking faults like this, and you can see them readily in the luminescence just by exciting somewhere non-resonantly and seeing the luminescence. They have slightly different energies like this. This is the spectrum of luminescence. You have some unstructured luminescence from the edges, and then you see from these triangles the luminescence are very narrow lines and basically a little bit high in energy. Those ones, green ones, okay, this is just false color. You shouldn't think that this is the real color of light which goes out of crystal. And blue ones from another pair. And these lines, so the parameters of the system is here. It's just bulk gallium arsenide epilayer. And actually, these lines are extremely narrow. The line width at low temperatures at 4 Kelvin is about 77 microelectron volts, which is comparable with the best quantum well structures. By the way, such kind of quantum well structures, the extremely narrow lines are grown in St. Petersburg University, and we have heard already something about this structures. But here, from a defect in gallium arsenide, you get a very narrow excitonic luminescence, and this happens if you really have these four staking folds arranged in a pyramid like this. And here the puzzles come. So our colleagues, experimentalists, they of course put this system in a magnetic field, and the magnetic field is arranged like this. So you have these four staking fold planes, and the magnetic field lies in the plane of two of those staking folds, which are labeled as up and down, so in the plane of red and blue. And it has both in-plane and normal components for the staking folds left and right. And then, just because the energies of the emission of left, right, up and down are different here, and because the position of emission is different, you can really separate the signals from different staking folds and study the dependence of the spectra on the magnetic field. So here, several representative spectra are shown. Here, at 0 tesla, okay, you see just the excitonic line. And for up and down staking folds here, for left and right here. So that's okay. Then you apply the magnetic field. Of course, you see quite strong diamagnetic shift. No problem. Of course, magnetic field shrinks the exciton. That's okay as well. And in principle, if you look at the left and right staking folds, nothing serious happens. You see the spectra are basically the same for left and right, and you have four lines in the spectra which reveal the Zeeman splitting of both the electron and the hole. That's okay, that is expected. This is what our colleagues have really expected to have. However, the drastic problem is here, the up and down staking folds. You have a pair of lines, and this is still okay, because for the heavy hole, the in-plane Zeeman G factor is very small, and there is no Zeeman splitting. Okay. You have just two lines from up staking fold and two lines from down staking folds. But the problem is that the energy positions of these lines are not symmetric function of the magnetic field. So you see, you apply, say, positive magnetic field, and the down staking fold doublet is here, while the up staking fold doublet is a little bit higher in energy. If you change the polarity of magnetic field, then, by contrast, the doublet of upstaking fold is lower in energy, and the doublet of downstaking fold is higher in energy. Some small additional peaks are probably due to the scattered light, and they are not relevant for the discussion. Moreover, although these spectra are normalized, if you look at the raw data, you will see that the intensities of the emission are also asymmetric functions of the magnetic field. So the intensity of one of the staking folds, say up, increases with the magnetic field, while the intensity for the other staking fold decreases with the magnetic field. And this is, of course, a drastic problem, because we usually know that, okay, the positions of lines and the intensities are usually expected to be even functions of magnetic fields. It's very strange that you change the polarity of the magnetic field and you see such kind of asymmetry in the behavior. The only good thing, at least at the beginning, is that this opposite behavior for the up and down staking folds is at least consistent with overall symmetry of this pyramid. Because in principle, you have two-fold rotation, which transforms up staking fold to the down staking fold and vice versa. And, okay, in this case, the symmetry of the spectra is restored. But still, it was not clear so far why the spectra, say the positions of lines, are asymmetric functions of the magnetic field. And so the only possible explanation for this effect is that the luminescence actually is caused by free excitons which propagate in the staking fold plane. In this case, the magnetic field, which is a pseudo-vector which changes the sign at the time reversal, is not the only quantity which changes the sign at the time reversal. There is also the wave vector of exciton which also changes the sign at the time reversal. And therefore, in principle, you can expect some kind of non-reciprocal effect that the positions of line are controlled by the product of exciton wave vector and magnetic field. And the simple phenomenological description of this effect is actually possible if you just construct the effective Hamiltonian for the exciton bound to the staking fold just from the method of invariance. Of course, you have the kinetic energy. The exciton can freely propagate in the plane of the staking fold. You have the electron Zeeman splitting, which is described by the G factor GE. Then you have the diamagnetic shift. It is also okay. It is also well known. And then finally, there is the term which explains the effect, a kind of non-reciprocal term, which is the Z component, so Z is the normal to the stacking fault plane, of the cross product of the wave vector and magnetic field. And in principle, such contributions to the effective Hamiltonian are well known in the theory of excitons, in bulk crystals, in cadmium sulfide and cadmium selenide, and they have been studied by the classics of excitonic physics, by Thomas and Hopfield, and then by Gross, Zakharchenny, and Konstantinov in different materials. So what is the origin of this term? How does it happen that the magnetic field, together with the wave vector of exciton, can change the energy? But by the way, of course, if you have fixed wave vector, you change the sign of magnetic field, and then you really see that the energy is asymmetric function of the magnetic field. So in principle, these terms explain the experiment. I shall describe it in more detail below. But first of all, what is the origin of these terms in the effective Hamiltonian? And the answer is very simple. So actually, probably the simplest explanation here would be like this. Let us switch to the reference frame, which is co-moving with the exciton. So in this reference frame, the static magnetic field produces effective electric field, which is given by this very simple formula. So one of the speed of light, the exciton velocity cross magnetic field. Now, if you have your exciton which is bound to the stacking fault, it is asymmetric. The directions of Z and minus Z are not equivalent. You can see it from this atomic arrangement. So exciton has a static dipole moment along the Z-axis. And therefore, this effective electric field interacts with the dipole moment of the exciton. And the interaction Hamiltonian, just kind of Stark effect, which was discussed previously today, it is the dipole moment of exciton multiplied by the electric field. And if you write dipole moment via the electron charge and the effective separation between electron and hole, and if you write this electric field via the wave vector and magnetic field, you come to this effective Stark Hamiltonian, or this effect is also called Magneto-Stark effect, to the Hamiltonian like this. It contains in-plane component of the wave vector and in-plane component of the magnetic field. And the wave vector of exciton is just fixed by the geometry of our system. So if you have a stacking fault, the light goes to the detector at some fixed angle, and so the component of the wave vector in the stacking fault plane is just determined by the collection angle and some geometrical factors. So this is the origin of this non-reciprocal term, the Magneto-Stark effect. And this is the experimental verification that it is indeed the case, because in the experiment, just by mounting sample on some very complicated holder, one can make a lot of experiments for different detection angles. And you can plot here this shift as a function of magnetic field for different geometries. Here, for instance, light is collected, which goes along the normal to the plane, and up and down staking faults in a sense are more or less equivalent, apart from this non-reciprocity. But if you tilt the sample somehow like this, so that the detection angle theta is non-zero, then up and down staking faults, the projection of excitons, of the exciton wave vector on the staking fault plane for a fixed detection conditions is different, and the Magneto-Stark effect is different. And then you can take all this experimental data and just fit it by very simple phenomenological expressions, which were presented previously. And without any fitting parameters, you really confirm this expression, and this expression for the Magneto-Stark effect. And finally, if you just take into account the values of this splitting in this range of small magnetic fields, you can estimate the dipole moment of the exciton. And the estimate is like this. The typical electron hole separation along the normal to the stacking fault amounts to approximately 100 of angstrom. So the dipole moment, the built-in dipole moment, is quite large. And actually, there are some physical reasons behind this. So I'm coming to the end of my talk. I have tried to demonstrate you that defect formed as a four stacking faults in gallium arsenide produce extremely narrow excitonic lines with a line width less than 80 microelectron volts. Next, In magnetoluminescence of stacking fold-bound excitons, one can see a strong non-reciprocity effect. Then the magnetic field is applied in the plane of the stacking fold. The spectra are asymmetric functions of the magnetic field. And this non-reciprocal effect is explained in terms of magnetostark effect, the interaction of exciton dipole moment with the effective electric field, which is produced for the moving exciton. And you can estimate the exciton dipole moment as about 100 angstrom multiplied by the electron charge. So to conclude, we think that the stacking folds in gallium arsenide serve as a kind of almost perfect two-dimensional potential which could bind heavy hole excitons, and these excitons are freely propagating in the stacking fold plane and can be applied to many interesting phenomena, including some collective excitonic physics in these systems. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Misha. So, please, question.
Okay. First of all, from the point of view of symmetry, it's quite obvious that such a moment could be, because if you just take a look here, you will see that the system has no reflection in the 1-1-1 plane. So you see here you have a bond like this, and here the bond is very different. In terms of microscopic model, you can have a kind of built-in electric fields here, just like piezoelectric fields in inverted structure. So our colleagues made some preliminary estimates based on what they know for what they expect from this kind of systems. And it turns out that the electric fields can be really quite large. And in this case, you can have a very strong mixing between the ground exciton state and the excited state. And of course, the exciton will have quite huge dipole moment. So of course, in principle, there is a problem for our future work, and we are working on it. How you can provide an effective model for exciton localization at this stacking fold, which should produce the observed value of the dipole moment and the observed value of the diamagnetic shift. So we have some preliminary estimations that it is okay, that it is consistent with some basic laws of physics, but of course, we need to go in more detail, and we expect to have some results in close future.
Okay. I see one more question.
Thank you very much for the interesting talk. Maybe I've just missed. Where does the exciton wave vector come from? From the excitation light?
No, from detection. So you measure the luminescence. So you have a fixed frequency at which the exciton emits, and so it has some wave vector. The total wave vector, so the wave vector component is given just by this geometrical formula.
Do I correctly understand that you study quite perfect crystal? And what happens if crystal is not so perfect? I think there should be inhomogeneous broadening of the exciton line. Yes, could you show example of a bad, so to speak, crystal?
Okay, let me see. Probably I have a backup slide with this, but sure, let me. Now you have seen everything I have. I shall just try to say it. So typically, if you just study the stacking fold luminescence, as it is known in the literature, for instance, in this Japanese work, they demonstrate the spectrum. They have quite wide lines of several millielectron volts, and fine structure is not observed in this case.
Okay, I think the last question, please. Yes.
Besides the magnetic shifts and so on, there is one more observable quantity which you can use to verify your future model. I mean just bending energy relative to the free exciton in the bulk. Did you observe it experimentally?
It's a good question. I would say that I do not have a number right here. I understand that the continuum spectrum is somewhere on somewhere higher, but I'm not sure that at least effective mass calculation could provide the binding energy, say, with the accuracy less than 1 or 2 millielectron volts.
Okay, thank you very much. We have to go on. Thank you, Misha, again for this presentation. So the next talk will be given by Vladimir Kovalev. And the title of the talk is Acoustic Excitonic Effect in Two-Dimensional Dipolar Exciton Gas.
Well, first of all, I changed slightly the title of my talk in comparison with the title given in your booklet. I added some phrase, the role of disorder. Our research were done in collaboration with Boev and Professor Chaplik in Zhanov Institute of Semiconductor Physics. I consider the acoustic excitonic effects in a 2D dipolar excitonic gas. Well, our research was motivated by recent experiments. The typical experimental structure is given in this figure. It consists of the substrate. The substrate is given here by this thin black line. And on the top substrate, the double quantum well structure is created. And there is on the surface, also there is some some source of the surface acoustic wave. This device creates a saw which travels along the surface, and this saw can interact with excitons which are located in this double quantum well. Electron holes are located in different quantum wells, and they can form excitons in direct or dipolar excitons due to the Coulomb attraction between them. I consider the Rayleigh type surface wave. These surface waves were predicted by Lord Rayleigh a long time ago. Surface wave travels along the surface of the substrate. If we have a double quantum well on the top of the substrate, this wave interacts with excitonic gas. So I will consider two different effects. So the first one is an attenuation of the surface wave, and the second one is the drag current produced by acoustic wave. I will also analyze the clean limit in the absence of disorder and the opposite limit in the presence of disorder, and also both in normal and for the condensed state of exciton gas. Let me say a couple of words about our model. So I consider the simple model. I assume that excitons are rigid dipoles. It means that we disregard the internal degrees of freedom of the excitons. I also assume that there is a contact interaction between excitons, and to calculate the responses, I used the weakly interaction model of the exciton gas. So a weakly interaction means that in a normal state, we can use the random phase approximation, and for the condensed state, I used the Bogoliubov theory. It can be easily shown that the absorption coefficient or attenuation coefficient of the surface wave is determined by the density-density response function, which in turn is determined by the polarization operator of the exciton gas. The form of this polarization operator are different in normal and with a condensed state. So let's go further and analyze different situation. In a ballistic limit, tau here is the exciton scattering time via disorder. So in a ballistic limit, we have the polarization operator is given by the expression which look like Linhart formula in electron gas. The difference only here we have a Bose type distribution functions. In a diffusive limit, we should sum the series of diagrams of so-called ladder diagrams. And now we have a polarization operator in contrast to the clean limit. Here we have so-called diffusion. And again, contrast to the electronic systems. Here, the diffusion coefficient depends on the current energy of the exciton. So I have to take an integral over all energies of excitons, taking into account the dependence diffusion coefficient on the exciton energy. Well, let's go to the result. So now in ballistic regime, the absorption coefficient depends on a frequency in the power of 2. So I will analyze only frequency dependence of the absorption coefficient. So in contrast to the electronic systems, in diffusive regime, we have an additional parameter. In our case, here, C is the velocity of acoustic wave. V sub T is the characteristic velocity of excitons. So in a typical situation, this ratio is small, and omega tau in diffusive limit also has a small value. So beta